pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Is there no microphone?
Well, we have to be recorded.
It's on.
Kyle, can you hear me there?
There you go.
Here.
Here.
Mr. Ranieri? Mr. Ranieri?
Here.
Mrs. Moore?
Here.
Mr. Farrell?
Here.
Mrs. Cal, Eleanor's on there?
She's here.
Oh, I didn't see you back there.
You're usually on.
Yeah, it's the little one down there.
Trying to change her luck. Mind me, never get seen.
Oh, I'm here.
Mr. Root?
Here.
And it's Ms. Pondish?
Present.
And Mr. Wright is?
Running late. Okay.
And Mr. Bashir?
Here.
Okay. Public notice of this meeting pursuant to the Open Public Meetings Act has been given by the clerk in the following manner. One, posted on the bulletin board in the borough clerk's office on January 6, 2015. Two, emailed to the retrospective curb post on January 6, 2015. New business discussion for the 11-4-2015 meeting. Public hearings on ordinance 1519, amending the towing ordinance, and 1520, abatement for commercial properties. Do we have language for both of these at this point? Are we good? Joyce, can you advertise?
Oh, you, yeah, I've already advertised, yeah.
There was one small issue on the towing ordinance where the chief had brought to the attention that for some reason, our original ordinance made it our responsibility to pay to advertise the abandoned vehicles. When the tower, he should advertise the abandoned vehicles and then he receives any proceeds from selling the abandoned vehicles. Do you remember him explaining that to all of us? Yeah, I mean, that's what it was, right? It was just, all it does is say that the towing company pays for the advertising. I guess he must have saw it in his budget last year, reimbursement for advertising.
Okay, so I'd also like to discuss probably changing the ordinance to reflect that the renewal would be every 3 years. We talked with a bit, John and Patty talked about it. We said it seems strange that every year the tower has to put in the application. And we thought maybe we should do it for every 3 years rather than advertise and
go
through the whole process.
Is there any legal statute to say, because I know certain contracts are yearly.
I would have to look at the
Borough engineer
would
have to do a 3 year, right?
Make that determination before I could give you a definitive.
Yeah, I don't know if there's a.
Could you look into that for us? Because it seems very.
Might be hard to do for this coming one.
Oh, but looking for the future, because every year we have to do the publication. It seems a little.
But we do that, to clarify. We do that. Engineers can be yearly, we can do engineers 3 years. Legal is usually yearly. Our insurances are yearly. Think about the insurances are yearly. But once again,
I mean, it's just a thought because it seems like 3 year versus every year.
Yeah. 1520 is the abatement for commercial.
I'm sorry?
You'll check that?
We can check that.
Okay.
And 1520 is the abatement for commercial properties. To clarify again, someone buys a property for $100,000. They put $400,000 worth of improvements to it. The property is now assessed at $500,000. The taxes incrementally go up over a five-year period of time. The borough reaps all of the money in the beginning until they're at the complete assessment, the final assessment, and then the money gets separated to all the other entities. And that's the way the law is written. We're not creating anything. I told you this is standard in Gloucester Township. They just did it with the outlets. So hopefully the few properties that are left, or anybody who buys a property in our community and hopefully fixes it up, will get a little bit of benefit.
What could that mean? That could mean anywhere from $1,000 to $3,000 or $4,000 a year for a new owner. Right?
Well, it depends on the assessed value.
What are the average properties around here?
Average property, it's tough to say. You know, Gloucester Township Outlet's a terrible example, but it's assessed at $20 million. So where they should be spending $250,000 of property taxes, they started off the first year at 10. And an increment went up to.
How do you even do that with Med Express?
Yes.
Those
kind of things. Well, that one might have been a payment in lieu of taxes. You got to be careful of those.
I don't know that.
Yeah, I don't know that. But I think it's a positive step forward, it's allowed by law, more than a few communities around.
It's a good idea.
You know.
It's another reason we're looking around here.
Yep.
You know, there's been some talk about on the last piece of property in our town that we own, to build a new school. Chuck Buckland is really kind of pushing that.
Charlie Buckland, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, so I don't know if,
Well, this would affect the property.
Would that be something?
Well, public properties are not taxed.
They don't pay any taxes.
They don't pay any taxes. So borough properties, public properties, the school, nonprofits, religious don't pay any property taxes. You know, we have veterans deductions, we have things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
So it wouldn't affect, it's like if we think about it.
In the big picture, it depends on what gets done, like anything else. You take a piece of land that's undeveloped.
What big piece of ground do we have?
In this community?
Well, it's not a piece of ground, Mr. Kelly, you're talking like maybe 7-Eleven. If the guy, company comes here, buys 7-Eleven and Rita's Water Race and the dental place and buys that for $500,000 and then puts $2.4 million into that.
That would be.
That's what this ordinance is coming up.
Yeah, and now we're looking at, you know, stepping that up to the 2.4.
If the Richards Group back, you know, decides to build another building back in that industrial park.
Yeah, we have open ground back there.
Yeah, they actually have a site plan approval, they have approval to build another section of that industrial.
So they would go, they would.
This ordinance would help them. And I think this ordinance might help the site that, yeah.
Is this just retroactive, any projects that were on the table, or anything that's all new?
It's all new.
I think it's all new. I think it's all new. Well, she's.
Are you familiar with this,
Abatements?
Abatements?
I have probably a six-page memo on abatements. You know, because the issue was presented to me, however, it was not indicated to me what type of abatement you were doing, which is why I have a very long memo on probably every type of abatement.
I don't believe it's retroactive.
So, you know, certainly with the, and we're doing commercial, correct?
It's commercial only.
Just commercial. All right. If you give me a minute, I will take a quick look at what I have.
What I know about the ordinance is the rules that are set in the ordinance. So if someone is going to take advantage.
What other town has the same thing?
Gloucester Township.
Oh, so you modeled this after Gloucester Township?
Yes, we called Gloucester Township, they sent us theirs, you know. I read the paper, Gloucester Township Outlets was the great example they talked about. My own personal experience, when I bought my building in Gloucester Township, I took advantage of this program in Gloucester Township.
Oh.
Where I bought my building for a lower value, I fixed it up and I reaped that benefit for 5 years. So your point was, what did it really save me? Well, my property taxes went from, you know, $4,000 and they went to, you know, $13,000. So I was able to step that up over a 5 year period of time. I think that might be more common.
It's very advantageous for someone coming in.
But the rules are, you must notify the municipality that you're going to take advantage of this program. So you have to basically fill it out before you start doing construction. So you do have to follow a timeline. You must let the assessor know. You must let the construction department know before you do all this kind of stuff. I don't think it can hurt.
But if you're looking at two sites, two different towns, it gives you a little more reason to look over here.
Yeah.
If you promote it, and I think we need to do a better job promoting it. I think if Rich was here, he would say during the interview that he had with the bond rating company that this was something that this town has to continue to do. And, you know, we have to do things like this to help.
We could promote it.
It's strictly commercial at this point. You can, and I've gotten a lot of pushback from, you know, some people.
The tax collector?
I know.
The tax collector?
I got pushback from Joyce when I first suggested it.
And Brian.
And from the assessor. And the logic from the assessor, as much as from Joyce, was I thought this might be a good way to incite people to fix their homes up in the community. But we'd have to set certain thresholds, certain standards. And it would take a little bit of work to do it, where you sit there and say, well.
Well, let's get started.
But wait a second.
Go ahead.
My
feeling is this. We're not talking about getting people to fix up the houses. What about the empty houses to get somebody to come in and flip them to try to resell them to get them occupied?
But that's an interesting question here, because if you, the assessor,
yeah,
when
I'm
he,
sure.
Well, those are called, they're called, what are they called? Not depressed values, but when the assessor is reevaluating, someone says, well, the neighbor's house just sold for $25,000. Well, that circumstance, you can't count that circumstance. That was a, I forget the word, but there's an actual term in appraisal. You know that word? Well, he can't use it, he throws that out.
It's an anomaly, I guess.
Well, not an anomaly, but you know, there's a certain circumstance.
It's damaging. packaged goods, basically.
Yeah, so that doesn't reflect the whole community.
Correct, it's like a
company's not gonna be able to take advantage of that if they're coming in to flip a house.
Yeah, I don't really want that.
Yeah, it would have to be stipulated to a homeowner buying it, and buying it at a low rate, at those houses that aren't owned.
A person that's in the construction business wouldn't be able to do that?
It wouldn't be.
If you don't, that's a good idea, get rid of it, I get it, okay, I get it.
In the long run, it's good for you, not short term.
Unless he kept it as a rental.
Well, if he kept it, then that's.
We don't wanna do that, though.
The example that was given to me was, say someone owns a home in this community, and they wanna move out, because their house isn't big enough. So they wanna put an addition on the house, they wanna put a second floor on the house. And with this, if we crafted an ordinance, and we were allowed to do that, where we had some thresholds and say, okay, if you're already in the house, and you wanna make your house bigger, and you invest a certain amount of money, then you would reap this 5-year benefit.
Okay, that's a good point.
But it's complicated, it's a little complicated, because you don't wanna allow someone who takes a depressed value, who takes this advantage of the depressed value, or the rental, or things like that. You know, if we could craft it in such a way that it benefits someone who's living in this community right now, and wants to take this smaller, older home, and really make it nice, and mostly it would have to be additions or.
Second story.
Yeah, expansions on it.
No.
Someone puts a $50,000 kitchen.
You buy the house and you're in there for a year. So they buy that house, and they fix it up, and they live there for a year, then they put the addition on, and they can take advantage of that, you know? So this way, the longevity.
So we could bring Brian in at one of these meetings one time, and, or even a small committee, it might be a good committee thing to talk about it, because he had some reservations, and like I said, the clerks had reservations, because, you know, where do you draw lines? Where do you define?
I think what we should do is definitely move on the commercial.
It's final reading.
Yeah, this is definitely. And then let's go into the
I like the idea that
a homeowner can take advantage of it.
Pays to get creative and come up with solutions.
Love to see.
You don't wanna have a community full of rentals. That's what I'm saying. No, what I'm saying, and I get what you're saying, and I get where you're coming from with it, but you don't want to turn it into.
You're building a duplex.
Exactly. They've got a bunch of people that are turning every single home that they've turned around for whatever reason into a rental.
What if someone was building a mother-in-law suite, or someone was building a second floor for more kids? I think those are the things. Okay, so we have those two ordinances. Resolution authorizing payment for Nancy Anderson for newsletter. Obviously, because she's not a typical, this was a one-time event, I'm hoping we're going to continue to do the newsletter.
You are?
I think we should do the newsletter again.
Absolutely.
You know, so we just have to figure it out, she helped us out.
When a new one will come out with the.
Well, this is fall.
Why did you put over your winter?
That's how it was supposed to be, that's supposed to be.
Let's try to do spring.
That's supposed to be the fall and winter, so we're going to go into spring, we're going to do spring and summer.
No, we started, it's like a little inertia, we started at zero, so now we got the ball rolling a little bit. The second one, we learned a lot from the first one.
Yeah, we did.
Okay, so.
That's wonderful.
You know.
People
just love us.
You know, but.
They love us.
You know, I think we learned a lot.
I'm getting nothing but positive.
We learned a lot about this, but look how much information was in this together. I think Ms. Passio, Ms. Renieri, a lot of members put a lot of time in, Ms. Anderson put a lot of time in, and.
So I would like to do a spring and summer.
We'll start with spring. So why don't we say that's our goal?
That's what I just said with that, we'll start with fall, what happened to winter?
But if you do winter stuff in there.
Well, this is fall and winter.
That's it, and then do spring and summer.
What do you wanna have, every?
Every 6 months, biannually.
Unless there's somebody's working money to get out there.
But if we get to the next level, now, here's the other thing, this costs us money to do this.
Yeah.
So, you know, some municipalities offset costs by a little bit of advertising. Do we allow some of our local businesses advertising?
If we allow advertising, we're gonna have to make that bigger.
Not much.
Well.
It could be bigger.
It'll be at least a big.
One page of advertising.
I think it'll be a lot bigger, because.
We'd have to see it with the.
There was so much that.
What the response would be.
There was so much.
How much will you save? Will it cover the whole nut, if so, something like that?
Sign.
Didn't that cost us what, $4,000?
No, it wasn't.
I think if I put that in a hard, you know they're gonna get it, but it's $20.
I'll tell you what people, you know that Fourth of July goes, and all the
trees,
that to me is my Bible. I look at Fourth of July goes with all the businesses, that's a Bible for me.
People will hold on to this for more than a month. This is something to hold on to, that's what we're
doing.
So the advertiser is gonna get a long-term.
Well, I think one of the criticisms from the community was our, you know, that, you know, we need to communicate more with people, so hopefully this helped that direction. direction. I think one of the things we've talked about is the news, the website really has to be a priority at this point. The newsletter is great, but the website, I think, needs to go to, I mean, it's okay, but it needs to go to the next level.
And that was our plan.
And that was it. Now that we had this under our belt, we go to the website, and let's just say newsletter in spring, summer, and then we focus on the website. Yes, it's very important.
Yeah, it's very important, but it didn't start till the 26th, so that was great.
How about planes, with something on that line?
Really?
No, as far as communication, get to the website, the electronic sign.
You know, we'll talk about that with Mr. Bayshore's report, if you're gonna go over that tonight. Obviously, we have great news about the building, hopefully. But the bids came in for the demolition.
I saw that.
He saw that, hopefully everyone saw that. But I agree, I think that it becomes, the borough now becomes the center of town. That parking lot almost becomes a little bit of the center of town. If we put a sign there, I still like the idea of a sign at the library, I do, because the youth organization, all the functions that happen in the community, we can use that sign more for public notices, that kind of stuff. I know you, but this sign, I think, hopefully will take over the other kind of stuff. Like Joyce sent out fourth quarter taxes, did you send that out? Yeah, and see, to me, I get that notification, I know you get that notification. Does everyone else get that notification? You need to sign up.
I also moved the sign up to the top, did you see that? That's the only thing that matters, see that?
What'd you do?
I moved the subscribe anymore. I have the, what's his name, it does it from, move it up to the top, now you can sign up for the.
Jeff Watts moved it up, wasn't it?
Jeff Watts.
Jeff Watts. And we're gonna talk to Jeff Watts, we've already had one meeting with him. But let everybody know, you guys, members of council, you need to go on our website, and you need to sign up for the notifications. You know, and the people out there need to sign up for the notifications.
I tell people to sign up.
But I will say this, it's not.
It lets you know what's on.
It's not excessive though, it's not excessive.
It's not.
Every time that something gets put on the website, you know what it's saying.
But if you briefly look at the, and Joyce is.
Well, that went out in all their tax bills, to please sign up on the website.
You did all that joke.
I did, she does all of this in the tax bills, and you know what happened?
We keep pounding it.
Well, we're like everything else.
Yeah, do we need to do that resolution tonight, or?
That'll be on the.
Okay.
It's for Tuesday.
Best practices, I hate to do this to you, but you guys need to do this, and Mr. I probably, why he's not here tonight. Follow through, we'll go through it, I do read fast. Mr. Bayshore, if you want to do your report, then you can get out of here.
He wants to.
And Ms. Nakamura, do you have any, did Mr. Wood talk to you in any closed session about contractual or personal? Did he brief you on any of that?
It wasn't you did today, it was.
We may have a closed session.
You'll need no practice.
The problem is, this guy, the tool, never sent the application.
Okay,
They seem to have it, like, in the office.
I know which one you mean.
I talked to him about it.
Best practice.
You will, we can do the best practices first. So best practice, just let her give a brief background, the state, when the new governor came in, started to establish best practices with the intent that it would force local governments to adopt the best practices that the state felt. With the carrot and the stick mentality, but right now it's just the stick. If you do not score high enough, money is deducted from the state aid that's given. Now, is it a lot of money? In our particular case, it represents about $35,000. So if we do not get a passing grade, we have the potential of losing up to $35,000. 5% of the last payment.
And if we don't do it with an acceptable job, it wasn't penalized. Officially fined, I think.
Typically, no.
Oh, okay.
Typically, no. It's, you know, this home rule mentality in this state allows a lot of flexibility for taxes. At least that's my personal
good
take on it. Okay, so there are, I think, 80 questions. And then, all right, I'll run through them. Green means good. Okay. Shared services has been promoted for many years. Joyce, you read much better than me, don't you?
Wait, can we just touch on them?
Yeah, can we just touch on
them? I don't have a.
I can editorialize much better.
Good, okay. Yes, please do that.
All right, Joyce, your job.
Okay, question number one. Are we doing shared services? Yes, we're doing fleet maintenance with Belmar.
Let me clarify that. You have to do a new one every year.
Yes, remember that.
You can't just sit on your laurels from the previous year. Next one.
The next one's not applicable to us, we don't have any settlements, we deal with. Hatcher's adopted a vehicle use policy prohibiting, yes, we do have that in place. And any,
why is it red? Well, let's see, it should tell us on the back here somewhere.
I don't know whether that was just.
There's a couple of yes.
Red color questions, perspective.
Oh, red is review question.
Answers not permitted.
Okay, so it's revision.
Has the appropriate administrative official reviewed the state comptroller's report? No, he has not, that's a no. I don't know if that's a new one or not, I don't know. We have a website with our budgets on, yes, we do, we have all that up there. Do we require elected officials to attend at least one instructional? We cover a lot of it during the year.
But the GIF is the one that most of us go to.
Does that have to be, you can't sit on all of that either, or does that matter?
On this particular one, it doesn't matter.
They pull the GIF, gets it every year.
Well, no, we have to go get continuing.
Right. We've stuck to the 2%.
We've done a very good job.
Contracts, yes. The FEMA National Flood Insurance Program is not applicable to us. Our ratio is 98.34, we're fine with that.
That's because we reassessed a couple of years ago, you guys remember that?
Yeah.
It was very, very important, Carl hadn't done it in how many years?
20 years.
20 years. And what that does is like it makes it more fair. If you keep it at true value, it's more, you know, new homes tend to pay more, older homes, you know.
Tend to pay more.
Oh, in certain cases, yeah, in your case. I think some people did very well, many people did well between you and the reassessment.
The next one is your financial disclosure, everybody filed? That was,
yep.
We did.
No problem. The next one, we does not apply to us. Finance and audit, we have our internal control process, and everything was fine with the finance committee. We had an issue in the construction office, but we rectified how that's handled.
It was a cash management policy where the cash was in one situation left overnight, and that doesn't happen anymore. Now all the cash is secure. Some municipalities have a cashier, and we're kind of quasi having a cashier to get that choice. Most of the money ends up in the front office.
The next one, this is prospective, so I guess this is something Rich is looking into regarding the mayor's fees for marriages and weddings. Whether or not 2007-5 is being followed. Are you, I don't know, are you putting in your vouchers?
I am doing it properly. I was the first, because when I first did my first marriage, I basically got a phone call and I'm supposed to collect the money. I'm like, I'm not collecting any money, you know? So what we're doing now is, if I do charge a fee, if there is a fee charged, it's all collected by the municipality. And then So I think Mr. Wright will clarify that I'm doing it the right way. My first marriage I didn't charge. And then the next marriage, it didn't stick, remember? It didn't stick because I had to do it twice.
That was the one we were witnessing.
But Rich, that is correct. I am collecting the money correctly.
Correct. Yes, we're doing it.
We're doing it right.
You weren't doing it correctly before?
I don't think the mayor was just going to see mayors, but just taking cash.
No, we've been, for a while now, we've been set up.
We have, okay.
Yes.
I'm not talking about, I'm going to other places.
Right.
Okay. You have it as perspective. That's why.
Yeah, why do you have his perspective?
Because there's a specific language in there that we weren't exactly in line with, so it was better to say perspective than to give a false answer. So.
Okay.
All right, keep going, Bruce.
The finance committee. Yes, we do have a finance committee. Audit findings, address areas. Yes, all findings include the corrective action plan that's been done, and there's the repeat findings you can read on the side.
Well, those over there will be mitigated by some action we're going to take.
It's a drift
in November. Correct, Mr. Wright?
Absolutely.
And because what we're going to do is we're going to have personnel to handle those things.
Rich does not do the...
Which one are you up to, number 16?
16. That was a finding.
The finding was that there was
audit findings related to the general ledger, so we can't have this until we figure it out, which probably 18 months before we can.
I was just going to say, how long? 18 months?
Probably about 18 months. I mean, it's one of those things where it could be like 27 things that have to be updated to get one audit finding to go away, so we're continually improving, but it's going to be a bit difficult to get that. Now, you don't have to get every single one right, but that's something, that's our main focus to make that one. I want to see none in the audit report.
15 and 16, yeah.
17, the grant programs, are they filed, the appropriations reviewed, quarterly determined that all the expenses? Yes. No, because either annual or the preceding year within 6 months of the close of fiscal year. No, we have a...
We're starting by 3 weeks.
30-day delay.
We're almost there.
The prior year was 180, so we've got significant progress.
A loss is a loss, right?
You know you don't have to read the last page in the record.
Oh, we like to go
through. No, I'm doing the short part.
Not accrued a liability or made payment to a grantor for question costs. We were fine. Not been notified that the amount that must be refunded to a grantor as a result of contract delay. 20. Do you want to do this or? Chief Financial Officer shall file their item of debt statement. That was done. Yeah. That's fine. Local finance and outstanding debt to abide by requirements. And the whole following: review the local finance notice and undertake it or cause you to undertake a review of the past compliance. Yes. Are we up to date and fully compliant with continuing disclosure obligations? Yes. Contracts. We have not.
We do not
passed
have any
pay to play ordinance. No, we have not. This does not. That's not going to apply to us. No. The prompt payment law. This is prospective.
We had some chuckles over
here. Well, that is because it has. I can't verify that we have it reviewed by legal counsel, but we are aware of the prompt payment law. The issue that comes into play there most of the time is that our major vendors, when they do major projects, submit things to folks before they submit them to finance. We start the clock when it gets to finance. So that's something that we can look at to
put
in place the process.
Why is it
We don't know, our payments and stuff like that?
Yeah.
That's not a simple
answer. It's not a simple answer, but I'll give you an example. I got an email today, and I responded to it, and I'm going to say, because you know me, I don't care. Diane sent an email out to one of our employees clarifying a problem. And I looked, oh yeah, I sent it to Ms. Pasio, and I like the way she responded, saying, I told you what to do 2 weeks ago. You didn't do what I told you to do 2 weeks ago. Until you do what I told you to do 2 weeks ago, it's not going to get done. Now, she said it much nicer than I would say it, and I said it to Patty because I'm and that's part of the problem, though.
They're not following the process?
There's a lot of issues. There's a lot. Things can get
positive
in a million different ways.
I put perspective because I like to have something in writing and have a process. Same thing with the next one is talked about, do we have procedures in place for emergency procurement? We do, but an emergency management plan, but it doesn't reference the QPA. So I wanted to go back and look at that and make sure that it refers to that. So
you're saying at our reorganization meetings, we'll change these cash management plans? Is this part of that?
No. The first one is just basically a law that you have to pay interest if you don't comply. Now, we've never paid interest, so either we have flexible vendors, and it's, again, a contract, not somebody who went out to the store and bought something and didn't do a purchase order.
Contract.
Yeah,
contract. Okay, keep going.
27 is professional services. Do we use that? Yes, we do use it, and we do advertise it in the paper once they are awarded. Do we
are we collecting surplus property? Have a written policy goal for the amount of surplus? Rich says we do. No, I don't believe what Rich says that we do.
Well, we actually are talking about, we talked about this the last council meeting, was whether we were going to put that policy, memorialize it through resolution, through the cash management plan or individual.
We're doing that yearly, right?
Yes. And that was one of the questions when we had the interview with Moody. She said, oh, you do? She said, is it written? I said, yes. She said, really?
Moody is very happy with us.
It's basically 60% of revenues on hand and 5 to 10% use in the budget. It's the basic policy. And then the overall theme, which is included in the budget document in the revenue section, states that our goal is to regenerate whatever we use. So there's the three categories where we have it written.
Okay. 29 is budget projections, and you do that.
Yes.
Look at what the impact of 1 year's budget will have on the next budgets.
Yes. Our budget prep worksheets have two columns out to the right. They have the next 2 years. Again, the question that we were discussing with Moody's, we basically do that based on 2% levy cap and 2% appropriation cap. So straight line projections, unless there's something that David, you know about.
Certainly.
Yes.
Payment service, this doesn't apply to us. This is the bond rating agencies. Will this apply to us next year?
Now, the county might guarantee a borrower's debt service as part of their accounting. We don't guarantee other entities' debt service. It's like the parent signed up from the student loan.
The next one, the answer is no. The elected officials receive a written status report at least quarterly. No budget.
You have one in, well, actually, you have one in front of you.
Yeah, you see it.
And we review them, and I give information on them, but the written part was bolded in here.
You see the
budget? Yeah,
why
is it?
So, you have it sitting in your hand. I just handed out everyone a copy of the third quarter written report.
Draft.
Well, that's because I'm going to review it and adjust it with projections.
Here, it's draft. Okay, 32. Is you have a multi-year capital plan. Yes. And we keep up with our sanitary sewers, our water systems. Yes. Our budgets, are they introduced by the statutory date? They are not. Who do we know that does that?
Actually, I went to a seminar on Friday. I went to a seminar on Friday, and their interpretation of this, because I read it strict to the rules, is if the Director of Local Government Services extends the deadline to X date or your next meeting, and they say that it's a yes, but the question asked, did you file by the 10th, then I answered it strictly by the 10th, and we may do that this year, coming up. That was my goal.
Yeah, but they'll probably extend it.
We did it 1 year, didn't we?
No, we've done it in accordance with the statutory guideline, but we didn't hit that date that they always extend. We want to do it without the extension.
Okay, 34 is also noted that we adopted before the 20th of March. No. Does your municipality exclude?
This is the health care.
This is 35. Is health care excluded for part-time elected and appointed officials? Yes. Do we conduct a monthly review of health benefit covered lives itemized? Yes. Yeah, it's a flat fee. It's not a commission. It's a flat fee we pay through our premiums, I guess.
Yes, we had to seek the proper language on this. Basically, the fee is approved by the Executive Committee of the Southern New Jersey.
Are you catching her? Feel free to read this at home.
Has your governing body had a thorough and adequate discussion about its current policy regarding payments in lieu of health benefits, its impact on the municipal budget, whether said payments are still warranted?
We only have, what, 3 people to get that now?
I take a different approach on this. Our answer is yes, and I disagree with the state. For some reason, the state thinks that a best practice is that you don't offer incentive to somebody. That means that every person out there that has the ability to get insurance coverage somewhere else is going to do the right thing and just say, you know what, I'm not going to have my benefits with the municipality anymore, and just go to the other plan. So we can pay $25,000 for family coverage, or we can offer an incentive for someone to opt out and pay them $4,800, and they can go get their other coverage. So every day of the week, I'm going to say the best practice is to offer the opt-out to employees. If they change the law that says that if you have the ability to have benefits someplace else and you can't do this, then we can change it. But you know, as long as you're legally allowed to do it.
We have 3 people that take that advantage from us right now.
Tony Beavers.
Not elected officials. Employees who could get health benefits but get it through their spouse. So it saves us $60,000 a year, the 3 individuals who go in there with their spouse. Instead of us paying $60,000.
Okay, number 40. This is conforming with the FLSA. We've eliminated comp time for the chief and captain, report time, and new side jobs for the chief and captain. We refrain from paying overtime to employees with this. PERC, the copy of our contracts, are we PERC?
We sent the first round, and we have a new round coming up, so I will send it.
You know, if you guys ever are really bored at night, you go to the PERC website, and you can read contracts.
Well, if you're less bored, you could go to the state website.
I am bored some nights.
We know it's sad.
I do it, right? I get it.
You can compare best practices from town to town, you know.
How about PERC decisions? Do you enjoy reading those? Aren't they great?
The worst part is you can't research them in an appropriate manner.
Oh, there's no way?
You know, there's no way.
No, you just got to read the
site. There's just no way. It'll say
2013,
2015. Yes. Well, that's fabulous, but you can read 100 decisions and they can all be different.
Wow.
You know, there's no topic headings of any sort.
It'll make it too easy for us.
That's why I try to keep carrying it.
Okay.
That's another good topic. Yeah.
42. Do we make salaries? Accurate records of employee time are critical to maintain, we use a time clock. Yes. Okay. As your municipal institute policy, we don't compensate for sick leave. We actually never have.
No policy modifies for sick leave.
42.
Do we have 42, 43, 44, 45. Does your municipality have a transitional duty program, light duty? Yes.
How do you say that we have all of our salaries? We have all our salaries online?
No, but we've multiple times I've provided them free of charge.
And the state workers' compensation law, this is limit benefits for work-related injuries to be both statutory benefit, and Rich says that's prospective.
This was an interesting topic at our weekly staff meeting.
Yeah, please expand on this so they understand where I was fighting.
The current policy in many governmental units, including the contracts that the Borough of Burnaby has, is that if you go out on workers' comp or disability for a period of time under our major illness provision, you receive 100% of your pay. And basically what the state is asking if you have worked in negotiations to try and have it limited to just the amount that you would get for workers' comp and for disability. So
I don't think you did. You didn't do a very good job explaining.
If I was to fall out of my chair tomorrow and be qualified for workers' comp under major illness, I would receive my full pay for 90 days.
You have to understand what the term major illness is unique to the Borough of Burnaby. We basically have treated our employees that if they ever get very sick or very injured, either through their personal life or working here, they get paid as if they came to work every single day, 100% of their pay. Understand that? What the state is saying, and what I've argued, is that in the other world, you only get whatever the percentage is, the 70%, the 60%, the 80% of whatever the benefit is. So we are contributing, both us and the employee are contributing into a disability fund, a workman's compensation fund, all these funds. But what we're doing is, instead of saying to the employee, you can reap the benefit of this fund amount, this 70%, 60%, 80%, whatever it is, our predecessors have said, no, pay them 100%. That can be very costly. We're paying 100% and getting no service, right, from the employee. And there's no incentive for that employee to come back to work, is what I also would look at. So we had an employee one point where we were, well, it's a little more convoluted than this, but he was supposed to, you know, he didn't file for the disability. We were still paying him 100%, and the chief loved to point out that we did. Finally, we said, we're not paying you anymore unless you file for disability insurance and things like that, so we would at least get reimbursed 70%. We still lost 30, but we at least got 70 back. My argument is that what the state is saying is, if we're paying into these programs, why aren't we just saying to the employee, you get what the program pays? Why would you get more than it? The problem we have is we've got past practice, we've got contractual obligations to do this. So what you'll see tonight, we will briefly go over it because you do have to vote on it next week. We have a public works contract that starts to make some changes in some of these different aspects. And it's going to take time. I mean, it's not easy. Unless the legislature comes in.
We've come very far since the first contract existed.
We've come very
far. We used to have, even though it wasn't statutory, the position in the past was on the uniform side, there was unlimited timeout, the way it was reviewed. We have changed that in the first round. First of all, we affirmed that statutorily that you can't be out on leave, including adding major illness to your sick and vacation time for more than 1 year. That's been in civil service case law, it's been in PERC case law. So the bottom line is you can't be out for more than a year. On top of that,
once the year ends, we stop paying. And that policy didn't exist prior. And we've had it happen here a couple times, even to some of the members.
Also, in the past, the employees would continue to accrue their time and not have to use their time. So now all the contracts and the position in management positions, you have to first use your sick time to a floor, basically a one-week floor, which is given now that we have civil service that allows sick time to accrue year to year without limit, which, you know, when that great benefit existed, you know, your time expired at the end of the year. It's important to have that so you don't have somebody with 500 hours out there accrue more hours while you're paying them to be off. So I think that we worked fairly with the unions. They saw the issue related to civil service, and there was definitely abuse in some of the units, and they recognized that too. And so in all of the units, we basically made progress over the last two contracts in changing that. But it still exists to some degree, so, which is the main thing.
Yeah, so to be clear again, currently, we pay 100% if someone goes out, where the state law says 70%. So we have to keep moving towards that direction.
What's stopping us from moving quickly?
We've contractually negotiated in the past giving these. It's in the contract. It's in the contract. That's what I'm saying. The employees have. I should be clear. Employees have. The unions have worked with us in addressing this issue.
Unfortunately, it's very hard. You know, when the laws change and when you're doing it back and forth, in essence, they're going to want something else. If you're dropping it now to 70%. You know, which is what the state requires, and what ends up happening is, depending upon how various laws are written, it can automatically take effect at that time, but because that happens, they want something else. So I don't know what that something else would be. It really depends on what.
It could be a larger raise, it could be more
things
they
might be looking for. Most likely is going to be higher wages. That's typically what it falls, comes down to, is, you know, the salary.
Yeah, it's a negotiation.
I think the most important part of that, though, has been our new internal process, that we do not pay someone for a major illness if the chief doesn't sign the letter, if it's on the police side, authorizing it, because in the past they just put on the timesheet for a major illness. We do not pay it beyond the amount of sick time if the employee has not filed the paperwork for disability, because we have to sign off on the employer share. We'll get the notice that they have approved it. So we basically we're holding them accountable for the rules that we do have, because that was lacking to a degree in the past, or misinterpreted, for lack of better terms. So we are definitely aggressively monitoring this.
It's a good one. It's a big topic. Very good. A lot of money. What's next? 47?
Okay, 48. Has your municipality eliminated longevity awards for non-union? Yes.
Have you eliminated longevity awards for collective bargaining agreement employees? Yes. Have your manuals been updated? Yes, the last one was in September of 2015, the last update. And that is the end.
Rich, you want to go over the summary?
Yes, the part that needs to be read in the minute, talk.
It's not for you.
I'm just kidding. So there was 32 yes, 8 no, 5 NAs, 5 perspective for a total of 50 answered. Score is 42 yeses, NAs, and perspectives as allowed, which is 84% with 0 withheld. And if the clerk could read the certification into the record.
I hereby certify that the governing body of the Borough of Runnymede and the County of Camden discussed the calendar year 2015-2016 best practice inventory as completed herein at a public meeting on 10/27/15 with the inventory results and the certification thereof by the Chief Administrative and Chief Financial Officers respectively to be stated in the minutes of said public meeting.
And that's
it. Okay.
This will
be fixed. So, we get our money.
We get no penalty. Okay, so we went past best practices. All right, we have a resolution. Is this for action tonight? Yes, it is. Oh, no, it is. Resolution authorizing various streetlights. We clarified that. No, I'm sorry. No. But we clarified there was only one issue. We had a couple residents that pushed back. I think Ms. Moore will look at it again. They can make a determination. I think the chief actually stated that he felt that it was a good location for it. So we'll give the residents another opportunity to argue their case and maybe difficult for us, but we have to, you know.
Bike
Path is a done deal.
That's a done deal. That's what this is resolution.
Yeah, so we'll do that. I don't think anybody had any problems with that last time we spoke about it.
Bike Path and Ferndale.
And Ferndale.
Yeah. And also you have to discuss the transferring the lights from the fire department.
I think that's part of this now.
I have a question. What is the wattage that's going to be on these? Because it's 50 watt now? Because it was 100? Back in the day?
They're LEDs. They're lower LEDs now.
I think they're only 50.
They're softer, aren't they?
Well, but they don't throw a lot of light. They're a waste of money as far as, I mean, I'm not saying light it up like a, you know, like a runway.
What light are you talking about?
All the street lights.
But then they turn the lights are.
But they have different wattages. The old lights that throw a lot more light, there are certain ones that are still around town, I believe are 100 watt, and these are like 50 or whatever the difference is. I think there's a difference.
Are you saying we have a say though?
I don't know. I think I'm wondering if we should. I'm wondering if that's something that we can ask. Like,
Are we talking the ones on the bike path?
We're talking in general. Like, the lights out in town have a certain wattage.
Paul, did you remember if he gave us any? Oh, that's my answer.
Yes.
Please come up, Paul.
That's a PSC.
Can you get up? Like a cat.
A few years ago, PSC&G went around to many of these towns and replaced most of these lights that Ms. Moore was saying that were not energy efficient. I think we probably replaced all the lights in town that were energy efficient, along with the solar panels on the light poles that you see throughout the town. PSC&G did not specify what wattage they are, but I trust that they know what wattage that we need out there. So they didn't tell me what wattage it is, but I walked out with the gentleman, he looked at the area, he, you know, we spoke about what poles he's going to go on. Most, you know, the poles on the north side, where between Fifth Avenue and Third Avenue, so we need every pole. From Smith Lane to Fifth Avenue, so we need every other pole. From Third Avenue, the railroad, so we got rid of our pole. I think PSC&G knows.
I'm sure they do, but there are some lights in town that are blue, and there's some lights in town that have an orange hue to them. There's two different kinds. So my question, that's what I'm just asking.
Yep.
Can
I never saw it as an option, I don't know.
I just wonder.
I don't think it's an option anymore.
I don't know if it is or not, but I mean, can we ask what color are they going to be? Are they going to be more that blue, or are they going to be more that orange?
I mean, it's like a leak anywhere. It's
probably a standard so it doesn't offend some of the houses too close by. and it's appropriate enough late to take care of it.
$9.
I understand, if you're not, don't argue with me, I have a lot more all over town, it's just over that.
Okay. So yeah, I don't know if we have much, you know, but I think we should approve that, I think it'll be approved, okay.
You wanna talk about the,
Oh, the fire company, I apologize. The fire company used to rent their parking lot, their overflow parking lot to the post office. The post office has been pulling back, so it's hurt their finances. They also have lights that they have up, that they pay a different rate than ours. And the rate is substantially different, they pay close to $40 a month, where the borough pays $9 a month. So we are allowed to do aid to our volunteer fire company, and this could be part of our aid to the fire company, where they have three lights that are costing, are there three or four lights?
Four.
Four lights that are costing $160 a month, for us it only costs $36 a month. So the savings is substantial, we'll save the fire company, you know, $1,200 by putting the lights in our name instead of theirs. I personally think we should just do it, I mean, if we can save their money, and, you know, and I think they do a great job, so we don't have to, yeah.
We have to approve by resolution.
So it'll be part of next week.
Yeah, I don't know whether, I might ask them if you want a separate one from, because it's a different person that hands it this, and who's,
You know, speaking about the fire company, in one of our public safety meetings, we discussed having a recruit and retain program established by the fire company. Kind of just give them some impetus to come out to calls and be like a little reward for the volunteers in the kind of like a gift certificate or something that at your annual banquet. Patty and John, we talked about this. We thought maybe if the borough could come up with like about $1,500.
Yeah, there's a way to do that. I mean, it is allowed. It's a tricky way, Rich. It has to be done a certain way, but I think that we can look in our budget and maybe put that in there as a little incentive.
I'd like to have it.
But we are giving them, you know, we're doing a pretty good job.
Oh, yeah. This would be strictly for retain and recruit. And it's their purpose.
A little incentive.
And it'd be a little incentive for the firemen themselves, the volunteers. There's no way we can pay these men for the work they do.
Well, if you pay them, they become employees.
Oh, no, we're not doing that. But if the fire company at least wants to have this incentive program to have them come out to calls and be rewarded in some way, this would be a good way to do it. And the committee came up with $1,500 that we would like to...
Well, when we're putting the public safety budget together, that should just be part, you know, look at this part. I think it's, you know, okay, it's that one.
I think at one point in time I had requested that they be responsible for the process and have that written and provide that for the safety, public safety committee to review, and maybe the solicitor just make sure there's no issues. Because they keep track of their runs.
The company.
They keep all that information.
How the money's distributed.
All you're doing is coming up with the awards. So.
Yeah.
Right. You just come up
with... You have to come out to 50 calls a year or 20 calls a year.
That's their, that's their whole, that's right. They're set that up. Yeah. What we're saying is let's give them...
But I think that has to be first almost, or that has to be simultaneous.
Right. Right. They would prepare the program to be approved, and then it would be funded.
Yeah, we would fund the program.
I don't think it's a problem. Based on the reports that I've seen them prepare for other initiatives, I don't think it's an issue. So.
I will tell Fred. Right. And he'll work with the chief on that.
Okay.
He and Chief Pat will work on that.
Right. Okay. All right, good. Resolutions appointing EMT special police officer and public work employees. Do we need to do any of that? Action this evening. Mm-hmm. No?
This is for Eric Speakman.
No.
Yeah, there's an EMT, and then there's two.
Ryan.
So there'll be.
The public works employees was for action tonight, I believe.
Yeah, I thought it is action tonight, because they're already hired.
They're leave guys.
They're supposed to start work.
I met them today.
All right, so what resolution would that be? Resolution 1544?
I have it. Isn't that right? That's because I was at the right place at the right time. Which was it? Harry Williams appointing? Did you tell me?
You have an email?
No, it wasn't email. It was a great memo. I love that memo. So it was a famous memo.
What was it?
Okay, let's not go for
easy.
It wasn't that great.
Paul wrote it.
Awesome.
What was it? Tell us second.
This is for Brian Beswick, the EMT.
He's not starting. That's not tonight. The Public Works guys have to start.
It's Public Works. It's Hank Schreiber and Nick Lopez. I know he sent me something else saying his name is spelled wrong on here.
It's only for two Public Works part-time employees. So we have resolution 144. Want to read their names and their salaries?
I have no idea what their salaries are. Hank Schreiber and Nick Lopez.
We can do a retroactive, right? Do we just do that, Rich?
What?
Do it retroactive? Just can't get paid until we put them on.
My last, the new hire authorization form includes the person's name, the salary, things of that nature that were supposed to be submitted to the clerk.
Nope. This is what I have.
If you give me a second, I could look up the last person and see what the amount was.
No, these are just, they're seasonal, 3 months, just to pick leaves up. What Tom, the reason I'm making kind of light of it is he wrote a very, he basically said leaf season starts.
Yep.
You know, if we put three guys on this vehicle, three guys on this vehicle, three guys on this vehicle, one guy running the street sweeper, with the current amount of employees, figuring that, you know, people are going to take a day off, people are going to get sick, we need at least one extra person plus a supervisor. We need to hire two part-timers for 3 months. I know, it was good. We got there. And it was nice to actually see some thought process. And there was a thought process. And, you know, he actually came up with what their salary would be, how much it would cost per week.
How come we don't know any of this?
Because it was sent to the Public Works Director.
The memo, sure.
And the person
saw what the cost is.
You saw it on person now.
Why is this the memo?
I'm going to skip it, I'll move on.
So
13, 18. It's contraction.
And their names are Lopez and what?
Schreiber.
Schreiber.
A C-R-I-B-E-R, because that's what he gave me. And Lopez is L-O-V-A-Z.
Send me your check down. Pictures. Okay, so we're going to do that right now? Let's do it right now. Resolution 144. Resolution to hire Nick Lopez and Mr. Schreiber for $13.18 an hour for part-time seasonal Public Works leaf waiters. Anything else?
Any motion? I'll make a motion.
To approve?
I'll second.
Second? Roll call.
Mr. Ranieri?
Yes.
Mrs. Kelly?
Yes.
Mrs. Fazio?
Yes.
Mrs. Moore?
Yes.
Mr. Root?
Yes.
I never got that memo.
Yes.
I got another one for some reason, Michael. I never got that memo either. So we're in the same boat, Ellen.
Okay.
And I'm the first to vote.
It's good company, right? Good company.
Resolution authorizing refund of permit fee.
Wait a minute. What about my EMT?
He doesn't need to be put on until the council meeting.
What about Eric speaking?
He has to be sworn in at the council meeting. Are you not reading the memos?
Okay.
She's
just I just want to make sure.
Mr. Daly, Chief, did you clarify when the officer
is
sworn in?
Eric will be sworn in?
Yes.
Now, will we be honoring Officer Amato?
Yes, I was going to talk to you later. Is that going to be okay?
Okay. All right. Okay. I just want to get my issues on the table.
I understand. Paul's got it. I think he was part of that.
Yeah, but I just wanted to clarify.
No, that's fine. A refund of a permit fee. This is just the fence one I was talking to you guys about before. It's going to be done.
I hope. I don't know whether or not. Did she get the...
She called me again today.
Send it out to get the...
I got a phone call again today.
But it takes...
I'm going to put up the $65 myself.
Good. Can we buy it through that?
You put your fence up.
She didn't.
No, this fence wasn't done.
This is a pre-existing non-conforming, she never did.
It was a zoning permit.
I never did.
It was approved by the borough.
The purchase order.
Yeah, pre-existing resolution.
Doesn't matter.
Wasn't approved by me, and I'm part of it.
Doesn't matter, you weren't part of the person that needed to do it.
Yeah.
I know, he just wanted to, he should put in work.
Resolution author, now this woman just, she didn't do the work, and she wanted.
She should have read one.
Resolution authorizing shared service with county for sidewalk.
Zoning permit.
I thought there was nothing that was required for a fence, I thought that was the understanding.
No, it's a zoning permit, is that correct, Mr. Mayor?
What's the question?
What is the fee for a fence, it is a zoning permit, correct? It's a zoning permit?
It's a permit, not a fee.
It's not a UCC permit.
It's not, you're not allowed by law.
That's $65.
To issue a construction permit, this borough was doing improperly for years. And when it was brought to our attention by the state of New Jersey PCA, we changed it, and we created a zoning fee, so at least the zoning officer made sure that the fence was put up properly, and did that.
I just want to clarify, I'm not looking for a fight, I'm just asking a question.
No, we've only talked about it for 3 years.
It doesn't matter, and we've been hearing about the other fence issue for a long time.
Just brought it up.
I'm just asking a question, because it was always understood that there was no fee for the fence.
No, that's not what was understood, there's no construction fee for the permits.
We understand that.
Permit.
Two different things, zoning permit, construction.
It's fine, give her her money back, I don't care.
Resolution authorizing shared service with county for sidewalks on Commerce Bridge Road.
Did we already, you didn't do this?
You said you wanted to talk about it at this meeting.
Oh, well, it's important.
Put it in for this meeting.
No, we authorized the engineer, this, I believe, is for the.
Yeah, we did the engineering part.
The work.
This is now the actual sidewalks.
Oh, this is important.
Mr. Wright, can we do this without having funding source?
$49,240, Rich.
Who said we don't have funding source?
I'm just asking, do we have a funding source?
Of course, I will, yes.
Okay.
The current road program.
Yeah, oh.
When me and Beth went out there, they said they were taking care of.
Taking care of what?
The sidewalk.
Nope, that was gonna be part, that was part of them, it was part of them paying for it, though. It was us paying for it, and it was us paying for it.
You're talking with.
Nick got it, Nick was in it too.
This is Clemens Bridge Road.
Clemens Bridge.
Oh, no, you're talking.
Because you knew that.
They're not doing it.
The point is separate.
Yeah, they're not doing the sidewalk.
Not doing any sidewalks.
They are not doing it.
His first, the point is, we have one different thing, this is Clemens Bridge Road. From basically Central Avenue to White Horse Pike, they're spending $2.1 million redoing stormwater and curbs and stuff like that. They will not do sidewalks.
This is Second Avenue and Irish Hill Road, and Clemens Bridge Road.
Yeah, right.
Second and Irish Hill.
Which is right there.
And Clemens Bridge.
That laundromat, yeah.
Is that right?
It's that laundromat.
They were, there's a little van down there.
Yeah, it's along Clemens Bridge Road.
It's along Clemens Bridge, yeah.
Second is where that laundromat is, but that's not Irish Hill.
Irish Hill.
She's saying where it's going, it's running from Second Ave to Irish Hill.
But there's, here's my, this is my question about that whole section, and this was my question to you originally about that, and I'm not being argumentative, I'm just asking, because when you start to approach Hill Avenue there, there's a big drop off of somebody's property. Is there gonna have to have a retaining wall put in?
The resolution I saw said a retaining wall.
So it does have the retaining wall.
Did you see it on the resolution?
I'm reading, construction of handicap ramps, driveway aprons and sidewalks between Second Avenue and Irish Hill and Clemens Bridge Road. That's what it says.
It doesn't say anything, that was my thing about the retaining wall, plus there are two houses next to the laundromat that I'm concerned, only as a resident, I'm concerned, because they basically have no driveway, so they pretty much park right in front of their house on what is some semblance of a sidewalk now.
The county is not doing this work until the spring. So if we want to table this, we can get a copy of their plans, correct, Mr. Bayshore? We can review it, see where everything is before we do it.
I mean, I'm for the sidewalk because there's no curbing on most of that side of the road. I'm just saying, it's like almost across from where Mac the Iceman was. There's a whole section there where the property just drops down.
Yes.
So then you can't just cut in. That's my only thing. I mean,
do you not believe, do you believe the county would put a sidewalk in and have retaining wall that would properly?
I'm not their engineer.
I really love that question.
We paid, I will, from the finance point of view, I'll say we paid $7,500 for the engineering review. What did the engineer review say?
What's that?
We paid the county engineer. What did they say?
I recall that there were
retaining walls. We discussed retaining wall. I don't know that the retaining wall is in.
How can you put a sidewalk there without retaining?
I I have no idea. How do you put a sidewalk in front of those houses that have sidewalks currently and they use them to park because they have nowhere to park? That's my thing. If we put a curbing in front of their house, where are they gonna park?
Well, if you remember, a lot of this goes back to the flooding of Clutchfield Church.
I understand that.
So the flooding flooded out the 100-some-year-old church. He did a very good job lobbying the county to go in there, and they put a, what's called an asphalt curb in to stop it. When they put the asphalt curb in, that eliminated the driveways, if you recall. If you drive out there right now, you'll see that. And some people have been pounding them down to be able to do that. So you either fix the water problem or allow people to get to their driveways as currently
built. But is that blacktop part only up to Second Avenue? And was there, was one driveway, I think,
I'm under the impression, that's why we got a little bit of clarification. I was under the impression that it was all the way down to where the church is, that the curbing was going there, and the sidewalk was going
there. But I'm saying that berm that you're talking about, that blacktop thing that they put in, I think that's only from Second Avenue to right by the church, because that's where they did it. I mean, curbing up above where it comes off of from Irish Hill down is definitely, and they were addressing the drainage issue as well.
Yeah, I think you look at it, I think that the reason we wanted to go in with them was that it was getting something done at the time they were doing it.
Absolutely.
You know, they weren't going to put the sidewalks in. That doesn't help us if we need sidewalks.
Absolutely. And they were agreeing.
But if we need to clarify exactly where it all is, I would like to know where it is. I don't think it's going to change my opinion about getting it done. Because anything's better than nothing right now.
Absolutely.
You know, we're going to walk away.
Except for a sidewalk on the hill.
We'll call it.
That's Kevin,
the
county engineer.
Sure.
2 seconds.
Okay. Well, I think
we've
got to get the
report.
I think we have to get the report and then go out there to see what's going
on. We'll get the plans and we'll see exactly what it is. Okay, so we're tabling that resolution.
Yep.
Plans.
Resolution 15-143 is action item. Resolution authorizing the issuance and sale of up to $5.135 million general obligation bonds. Anyone want to discuss this? This is basically our current short-term debt that is being sold in the bond market. It's going to be sold before the end of this year, and it'll be paid out over a period of time of, 15 to 20 years? Oh, there it is, gone.
2031. 2016 to 2031.
Looks pretty good. Are there any questions on this?
Do you have a section?
So as you can see on the back page, it was the ambulance, it was the other capital improvements, Eagle Grant Park, road improvements, fire truck, purchase of the properties, capital improvements, and sewer utility vehicles.
All good stuff.
Is there a motion on the resolution?
I make the motion that we approve the resolution.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. Roll call.
Mr. Ranieri.
Yes.
Mrs. Kelly.
Yes.
Mrs. Passman.
Yes.
Mrs. Moore.
Yes.
Mr. Root.
Yes.
And Mr. Fowler.
Yes.
Okay, there's one thing that's missing on here that I don't know if everybody's read about it in the paper, and it was sent to us. Through me was the county passed an ordinance not allowing for pet stores to sell puppies from the mills. Most municipalities are following suit, so you have the county.
Not necessarily just from, I mean, they feel that all pet stores get their animals from mills, so there's no more buying them out of pets in a pet store.
So,
where do you buy your dogs from?
Breeders?
They're
actually asking you to go to the shelter.
But you can't go to a pet store and buy
it.
No.
Think
about it. When was the last time you went to a pet store
and
mall? Or pawn? Yeah.
So to be in
continuity
with the rest of
the
communities.
How about fish?
Fish
are all
fish.
Fish
go under the wire.
So what I'd like to do, as long as everybody's not in disagreement, you agree, Ms. Passman, you understand this, I don't know if anybody else has. Really, it's a non-controversial issue. I think we should adopt it.
It's a staple of America. It's a pet store.
That puppy in the window, there it is, it's born, Mike.
Pet stores are still allowed, they don't want you to be selling, you know, dogs.
Not selling dogs from the mills.
Because they're coming from the mills, that's how they.
So, without any objection, I'd like to put it on this first reading at the November's meeting.
Yes, absolutely.
Or?
Absolutely.
Scally, right, you think, right?
Wonderful, wonderful.
You can vote no over there.
Pet stores are horrible.
Please, if you could. For you to review it. What they did is they gave us a boilerplate, each municipality got the same law. And the idea was the county passed it, all the other municipalities.
And that's where they came from.
Came from the county, that is very simple.
People just walk around, I guess, all the old people just walk around.
Okay, so, what do you need, Mr. Ryder?
I went there, I never picked.
All right. We'll go around the table next.
I tried, I said, I did.
There is, like, in Washington Township.
No, no.
Not in.
My thing is, the point is that if there was retail space in here.
Right, we can't raise something too much.
Yeah, I mean, this is standard boilerplate type.
It's plugged in the municipality. Yeah, Audubon passed it, Voorhees was one of the first ones that passed it.
Well, they have, I think they have a whole.
Voorhees, Cherry Hills.
Right, you can't have any, right, you can't have any airspace, you can have the other day. What's that?
This is what, way back then.
I actually asked.
I got. I must have put the, November 4th polls in towards March.
We're gonna go around the room. When you're done, we're gonna go around.
See, I'm saying, Claude just bringing up the same issue that we just got to that five-year patient. Do you have to do a plan for access, remember?
Here's my thing. This is all the state of New Jersey. This state of New Jersey gave our answer that I accept. Even though it conflicts with other people's answers, I'm taking the answer I want.
The document that we're working.
In many things, because I've researched a lot about this in the last some time, the state of New Jersey doesn't highly regulate these things, unfortunately. They don't have the time, many times at this point, they don't care. What ends up happening is there are certain requirements in which once a plan comes together, there's certain things you have to send to the state. They're not even looking at that at this point. Eventually, they'll get around to, well, we now have it from these various municipalities that you're supposed to send in the paperwork. There's a form you're supposed to fill out within a 30-day period and send to the state. From my understanding, they're not even looking at these. Okay, so there's been a.
So what would be the fear of at least moving forward with this?
The fear is, and typically with, you're looking at a redevelopment plan, and typically what happens is, you have to determine what areas within the municipality are appropriate for that. Mm-hmm. So what ends up happening is what municipalities are doing is they are making, in essence, granting the permission for their planning board to do an investigation and come up with a plan. Now, typically, the plan before a public hearing, you're gonna have maps showing the boundaries in the plan, okay, for people to look at. Setting forth the basis for their investigation. And that's all, in essence, supposed to be done and presented. The planning board is supposed to present that to you before a public hearing.
But this is not a redevelopment.
I'm sorry?
This is not a redevelopment.
Right, but you have to have the under, this is for an, it is, it's an underdeveloped area. The reason you're doing this is because you're, in essence, trying to get people to, whether it be
buildings
and things like that.
Vera already did this. They already did a special economic development zone in the borough. Did this already.
Well, when did you do it?
But they did it a long time ago in a certain area, which was both a combination of residential, commercial, industrial areas.
And is that still all applicable now?
I guess so. We did a master plan review.
I don't know that answer.
About 6 years ago, we did that. I was under impression, because where we got this was directly from Gloucester Township. And I see what you're saying, what comes first, the chicken or the egg here? You know, I was under the impression that this was only applicable to commercial zone properties. So this would apply to any commercial zone property in the community. My personal experience was, I did not have to do anything more than be zoned in a commercial zone in Gloucester Township to take advantage of this thing. I know, you know, I understand what you're saying. Those seem to be pilot, you know, payment in lieu of taxes things, right, and all that other kind of stuff. When Joyce called the state, obviously our assessor's saying something a little bit different. I think Lynn said something a little bit different. But
everybody
had a different opinion. And
you know, so, he in essence came to me and said, well, the state says this, and this person is saying this.
Right.
But if you read Gloucester Township's ordinance, it does not, it doesn't say go to map and see if you're in this zone. It basically said, and that's where we got this from that town card to send over, it was just the commercial zone.
Well, it was just anything that was zoned commercial.
Zone.
And this is where, and we're having, Len is the one that told us first that we couldn't just do this. We had to go through this process. So I called the state, and I spoke to someone there, and she told me, no, you don't have to do that. And then our assessor said, oh yes, exactly what you just said, the planning board, the public hearing, the whole works. So then I called Pat Turin up at the state and said to her, look, I need some guidance, I'm getting different answers. And she told me that there is, as long as you're not creating a zone, and they're not creating
a zone,
that there is nothing that you need to do except to pass the ordinance. They don't even require them to get a copy of this. But, you know, Audra, I am so confused, because how many different people...
I agree with you when you create a redevelopment zone.
Right.
I think this is a way to bypass
the redevelopment. I think some of the statutes are differing from what the state is saying. You know, in essence, when you make an agreement, whether it be with whomever the commercial property is, there has to be paperwork sent to the state.
Correct.
About that.
And it says there is an application.
There's actually a form, which I printed out from the Treasury website, okay, that says within 30 days of this happening, you have to fill this out and send it to the state. Not that they're going to look at it, not that they're going to do anything with it, but...
And that's what I said with my experience. You had to fill the paper out at the beginning of the process.
Yes, you have to apply through the assessor, right, with a form that's been promulgated by the state of New Jersey. But she said there are advantages to creating zones, though. If you want to go out for grants, and you want to do tax deferred,
It took us 90 years to get to this point.
I understand.
Can I get this
done? That is why a lot of people do the zone, she said.
Maybe that's step two.
But that's like a 6-month process.
Yeah, exactly. Right. But do you think we can sign off on this?
I'm just going to let you know, I have some reservations about moving forward in the way that...
So once we have, so you're saying once this is an ordinance and someone comes in, they have to go to our assessor, get this form, fill this out, and send it to the state.
Well, the person does, the property owner does.
Yeah, that's the experience and I understand.
I think
that's what we were trying to do. Does everybody agree to the difference between a zone?
We know that.
And
we do have a zone.
There is a redevelopment zone on 9th Avenue.
And we know that.
9th Avenue all the way from the Turnpike to 9th Avenue. It's a special economic development zone.
Isn't it in District
4? The SED, whatever that's called.
Special economic
development. We do have that. We already have that.
I think part of the problem is they're interchanging some of the terms they're using. A rehabilitation zone, and then they're using a redevelopment zone. And I think what's happening is the state is using, saying, oh, well, you don't need it for redevelopment, you know, necessarily. However, if you're looking at a rehabilitation zone, that's where some of the statutes are coming in and saying, you really need to do a plan, you need to have an investigation done, and those things need to be presented at a public hearing. Because the public is not going to necessarily know exactly, in essence, you're adopting an ordinance, but how do they know what particular commercial properties or in what area you're going to allow this to happen? I don't know if the ordinance, and again, forgive me, I haven't read, you know, what Len drafted. I don't know if it says that.
Yeah.
But
I'm under impression it's very specific that it only relates to the commercial.
Anything in zone, any property with zone commercial.
Non-residential.
Or apartments. What would they be zone? Commercial, apartments?
That would be multiple dwellings.
That's what I was worried about. I'll give you a copy before you leave.
I mean, I don't think this is gonna be this great catalyst that we hope it'll be. I think it'll be maybe a little bit of something.
Maybe somebody or two.
Yeah.
We don't want apartments to get taxed.
It's not necessarily a terrible thing.
So is this on the table, or is it moving forward?
No, I think we should continue to move forward. The reason I hate to be the bad guy here is because, you know, once you, I hate to say it's like a lawyer. You hire one lawyer, he tells you yes, you hire the next lawyer, he tells you no. You pick which one you wanna, I picked the yes. Well, maybe it doesn't reach anywhere. And the state, and like I said, you've got names, you've got people you've spoken to. I mean, I agree that we need to investigate it more, but let's get the ordinance done and then see what happens. Hey, I did my first message.
That's what you hired the ordinance for. And we cried, we shed tears.
I did a marriage and there was no paperwork. And dummy me never looked at the paperwork until after I did the ceremony. And they're like, here's my birth certificate. I'm like, here's your birth certificate. What am I supposed to do with this?
Everybody take pictures, we were crying.
You're married, just kidding.
You're married. And come back 2 weeks later, cheers.
Cheers, now how was that? Make a decision.
I go around the table, Ms. Moore, anything?
He spoke so well.
Mr. Bayshore, you wanna go?
Sure, first of all, I appreciate you trying to get me out of here, but because of your special meeting next week, I won't be able to be here, so I'll be able to go through my report thoroughly and not just rush to it. Just to go a few things, under general engineering, we got our state aid application in on time. Last year, we did not hear results until June, so I won't hold your breath waiting to find out about South Lake and Washington. There was an issue with the tax assessor and our code enforcement officer, so we're looking into a tax map issue, just to let everyone know that on Oak Avenue. Has to do with a block and lot not appearing on a tax map.
Can I stop you there?
Sure.
We adopted an ordinance that charged $75 to update the tax maps. Have we been doing that? You can answer.
I don't know. Okay. I don't know if your planning board engineer is
submitting it to you guys, though.
Well, we haven't been getting it.
That would only be for a subdivision, correct?
Every subdivision or lot line adjustment.
We've had at least
a half a dozen in the past 6 years, and you don't remember updating?
I know we did one when Philly Diner consolidated, and we had collected additional fees, but we haven't gotten anything.
Did we do anything on Second Avenue when we did the Second Avenue property?
Deluxe did a lot consolidation, partial lot consolidation, when they did that. Do you remember doing that?
The engineering committee wants us to look into putting some left turn arrows on Clemens Bridge Road and the Shannon Black Earth Bike Race. So we're coordinating with Shrop Car to see what would have to happen with that. We didn't do any studies or if they have any connections at DOT. So we're going to move forward with that and get some information. We're also going to help out with some cost estimates for potential road projects and also some various capital improvement projects. The good news that the mayor was talking about, we took bids for the demolition of the building next door, and the apparent low bidder is Delphi Engineering and Contracting, and their bid amount was $126,591.19. Len's currently reviewing all of the paperwork, so hopefully they'll have an answer by next Tuesday or next Wednesday, so that we get awarded, and then we can move forward with that project.
How long would a project like that take?
I believe we have a 60-day contract. Hold out.
In the
60s for substantial completion, 75 to take care of any punch list items.
So, what buildings are we demolishing?
Who was next door?
You sound like that. We're doing the second one, speak loudly into the
mic.
You
tell everybody.
We're reviewing the bid documents in Delphi.
Yes. What are we doing?
We said enough times.
People out here.
The only reason I asked is because he's off with Florida early next week. I just want to follow up with them.
Yes, exactly. Make sure you review those bid documents. Send them an email. Copies somebody else.
Okay.
Colleen.
Who is it?
When will the store?
Chris.
Well, I'm going to go over that right now.
I'll make sure.
So, Mark, just to be clear to everybody in the audience and listening at home, these are the four buildings adjacent to the borough.
Five.
five buildings adjacent to the Borough Hall will be demolition for future parking and ADA accessibility, public parking lot. Your pre-construction meeting, when will that happen?
So we can get contracts. Once you award by resolution, then we get contracts out to the middle bidder. If they have 10 days to get the contracts back to us, and then at that point, we can.
Because at this meeting, both the police department and the fire department have shown a lot of interest that there would be an opportunity for them to go in there and do some training and things like that. So at that pre-construction meeting, if you guys could invite those two.
Well, I would suggest they go in now and do it before we even turn over the project.
Do these businesses?
Do you think that would hurt the building getting done at this point?
You got also have to worry about there's asbestos in there, so it depends on what they want to be doing.
I will review that.
We've already discussed that at the CFP meeting, so we're going to do it.
I think we were, but now that we've awarded it, I wanted to see if the contractor had anything. So you wouldn't do it after you turned over the contract.
Does this fit into the HVAC removal and all that?
I think it's everything. It's a whole bill.
Oh, good. So not to worry about pulling all those things.
Well, we'll talk about it again.
And you also have to worry about the utility companies. I got a phone call today, the same gentleman that called me about the water down at the point, saying that, we're going to be taking the water lines from the building soon.
Yes.
So that's been going on since August. This is how long it took them even to get to the point where they can remove it. And I don't even know if the electric company has taken the meters out yet. So it's just a long process.
Yeah. Okay, well, we can talk about that some more. Okay, go on.
And then in conjunction with the parking lot and moving on to the next page, the space planning here, we're going to work those together so we get a new entranceway that's coming off the parking lot. Going to be ADA accessible and make it a lot more visible for the public along the Black Horse Pike. So we're starting that work as well simultaneously. The South Open Avenue project's moving along. We had a little bit of a problem with a gas leak yesterday. Apparently there was an unmarked service line that got hit by the backhoe, but these things happen occasionally. Singley Avenue project is almost done. I think we're just in the punch list phase.
Very nice.
Who's that? Yeah,
I go by there all the time. It's really big improvement.
We got to go back and do that. The one stop sign. The one stop.
Yeah, it's in the contract.
They're
out there today. I got a call.
You mean there's one that's missing? Stop sign?
No.
They're writing one on the asphalt. Yeah, it's like the line.
We replaced what we took out. If it was there, we put it back. The slip lining project, we've been dealing with DEP comments. We're getting reviews from 5 different people. We're trying to get them all put into one package and we just send it out. We do have the final paperwork now for the general permit number 1 for a stream encroachment, so we want to submit that next week. And under the public works garage, the news on that is that the application that the licensed site remediation professional did is complete. We want to submit that to the state. We're requesting $982.
$982,000?
$982,222.10 is what we're going to request in funding for all the studies that might have to happen, hopefully.
Studies or cleaning?
This is studies. This is the studies.
$982,000 to study?
Based on their criteria, yeah. But you can get funding from DEP, and then sometimes they start to relax what has to be done. They'll say, okay, well, we don't have to do this, so now we only need.
Is this the gas tank?
This is the gas tank.
Yeah, this is in the garage.
This is the study.
Which we have been working on.
The study of the gas tank.
Study.
And
you can pay me to stop seeing how good it does. Me and you.
It's right.
Why go there? Study.
Why do we have to pay so much?
Mr. Basher, you want to elaborate?
Why do we have to pay so much? This is crazy.
Soil samples. You have to, there's all sorts of studies that have to be done. What DEP was requiring, you just can't go in and just tear things out, which is what they tried to do before. They tried to just pull the tanks out of the ground before, and now the soil is contaminated with groundwater.
Well, that's the whole deal is the water. Isn't there some stream there?
Right. There's an underground stream, and the stream's contaminated.
That's the kicker there. If it was just soil, they could just sample soil, probably it would be like 800,000. But,
no.
But yeah, it's the water and the stream.
This is funding, it's a grant that you get from DEP if they so choose.
And that doesn't start the cleanup?
No, that's what I'm saying, I mean.
And we are currently. We are currently in compliance with regulations, at least through 2017, at this pace.
Okay, thank you.
That's all I have.
Great ending.
I don't know if Steve will be here next Wednesday or not, he has a, currently has a conflict, so it's possible he may not have any representation here.
That's okay. Well, we're the demo and, yeah, we've got your opinion. Did we, did you want to vote this at all, or you want to vote for yours? Did you pull this out for some reason?
No, I was looking for.
Thank you, Mr. Renee.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm gonna start with the budget review that Rich had passed out. We have, up to date, we have met or exceeded our projections as far as our expenditures go this year, which is good news.
You know, revenues came in higher than expenditures, or were above our expenditures?
We've spent less than we had projected.
Today, we still have a quarter left to go.
Right, but that's good news.
Paul?
Why are you wrong?
No, he has no money, he's not.
And Rich had mentioned to me, some of the reasons that our numbers are looking pretty good is the lower cost in fuel this year, gas prices have come down, and our EMS has generated quite a bit of income. So that also helps with the numbers. As Rich had said previously, our long-term financing, we were looking at that a little while ago. We've got a couple of dates that are upcoming that are important. We're still being evaluated by Moody's, and Rich has a phone appointment next Tuesday to put an end to our evaluation. We're looking to come in as high as we can, and it's looking pretty good. We have a lot of things going for us in town as far as our assets, our cash on hand, our current operating staff has been here for a long period of time, which really brings our rating up. So things are moving forward with our long-term financing. And I have a date schedule here. There's been so many changes, I think.
I'll get specific.
Yeah, Rich will give you some specifics. And other than that, progress.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Kelly?
Well, we have a new officer going to be sworn in, and we have an EMT that's going to be hired. I think that's all the resolution that we just discussed. And we're going to be honoring Officer Amato for his investigation work that he did this summer.
That's fine.
So, with that, I'll just.
We're going to skip to Ms. Spasio, because I think they both have to go somewhere. Did you want to?
Okay. I want to tell everyone that Mayor and Council invites all the residents of Runnymede to our annual Halloween party, which will be on Saturday, October 31st, at the Harry Williams Community Center from 6 o'clock till 8 p.m. There will be music, there will be refreshments, we will have a balloon contest. We will also have lots of treats, and Municipal Alliance will be there, and also Clean Communities. So they'll be giving out some goodies, and also we will have our candy apples contributed by gardeners. And the Halloween Day, it's from 2 o'clock till 7 o'clock, which will be trick-or-treating. So we invite the community and our children to come on over and have a good time. And also I'll be at the Harry Williams, so you can give me a call. I sure do need some volunteers. You know, people always want to get involved in the community, and this is a really good time. So I'd appreciate any phone calls to come on and help me decorate. Thank you, John. John came yesterday with Mary Jo, and that was wonderful. And I have few others that came out, so we're getting there. We're getting there.
Good.
And Christmas, the Christmas lighting, the tree lighting, and the fire truck parade will be on. So mark your calendars. Will be on Sunday, November 29th. And there's a lot of good things that are going to happen. So we're going to have some entertainment. I reached out to Belmar for their stage. So they are going to bring us over the stage at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So we're going to have a stage. We're going to have entertainment by an orchestra. Do you know the name of the orchestra band? Do you know by any chance?
Get
me that name and tell Tara that 5:30 is a good start.
Okay.
So 5:30 to 6 o'clock, and that's a contribution from the Rotary Club. I thank the Rotary Club, yes. Yes, for the orchestra and band, and also
band.
For some toys for our children. So 5:30 to 6:30, and then we're going to have music. And maybe someone else, I'm not sure. So we'll have music starting at 5:30. Then we will have the fire truck parade will begin at 7 o'clock p.m. sharp. And then right after that, you will have the Christmas tree lighting, which our mayor will light the tree. And I don't know if Santa, I think we're going to just direct Santa into the
orange.
So. So I'm looking forward, Mr. and Mrs. Close are coming again, yes, on the flute, and they'll be in the parade. So it'll be wonderful. We're going to have toys for the kids, and the balloon girl, she'll be there again. They love the balloon artist. So yeah.
Quick
so,
question, yes. For Halloween, 2 to 7, what was 2 to 7?
2 to 7 is the trick-or-treating, that you can go out in your costume and trick-or-treat, knock on doors.
Oh, you're saying that's the
best? Yes, that's the trick-or-treating.
You better stock up on candy because it's a Saturday.
Yeah. So, and then...
It comes down
actually. Yeah. They're giving out full-size bars down this street.
She's right by the school. I'm on a dead-end street.
Yeah, you get a lot. Yeah, I get a lot.
I get two kids.
Over 100 kids.
That's it.
You should do
it. You don't get any.
I get the kids around our neighborhood.
I get like over 100 kids.
Christmas.
I get crushed every year.
So you don't want to throw us the lake or the stream?
That's why.
Okay, do you guys need to go, or are you okay? Are you going to wait for them? Oh, Bob needs to go? Okay.
Yeah, most of the things I wanted to talk about, Mark talked about it. And I would singly out there. Thanks, Mark. You did better than I ever did. That's for sure. One thing I want to talk about is East Shamrow St. Teresa's. That park isn't working.
Did you tell Paul?
No, I'm telling him. I apologize. I didn't want to blindside you. I apologize. But I've been riding past it. It's confusing, the traffic pattern. People don't know what to do when people are parking for church. They're parking there.
They're parking for church on Concord Road?
No, on East Shore.
On East Shore.
Really?
It's not yellow. It's because it's not
yellow. No, it is yellow now, but it's 271 feet in from the Black Horse Pike.
They're parking in where it's not yellow. That's where
it's not yellow there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, where the Black Horse Pike to the school is not yellow.
No, right. No, the black, it is yellow from 271 feet in, and then it's 250 feet of yellow.
They're not parking there.
Curb is yellow.
On East Ham from the Black Horse Pike to the rectory, they're parking. And
right there, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because the curb's not yellow.
It's very yellow. It's very big.
Yeah, they push the traffic this way. Now with the cars there, they're riding over
yellow. Are you saying because the yellow line stops at a certain point, they're not parking where the yellow line is now?
Right.
They're parking.
But they're seeing now that that's yellow and that's not yellow. They're
so
going.
They're
not
but it's
yellow.
A lane.
You know, it's been not painted forever.
But it's a lane. They moved the traffic pattern.
Yeah, the pattern. Right.
So they push the traffic out to the middle of the road.
So what's the suggestion?
Sign that it was.
No, we got to paint it all the way.
You got to have to paint it all the way.
That means we have to change the order.
You have to change the order.
Are we going to have to change it?
But Paul, I thought about it. Just give permit parking to gardeners and it solves the whole problem. There's nothing wrong if it's a funeral and it's permit parking.
It's an enforcement issue. It's an enforcement issue.
This is a county road. Yeah. When we get our parking permits, you have to buy by the county says, not by the town says. We need permission to even put that up there.
Well, they recommended to make it no parking to Detroit
High
School.
Right.
You should have seen their recommendation.
The count.
And the other thing is, Paul, there are signs that were put up
or
or not very, even though they're visible, they're not very visible.
Mr. Farrell, I believe that to remedy this problem, the only way would be take out the left-hand turning lane.
Yeah, you can't take that.
The county, this was something that we asked the county to come in and help us. You wrote the letter and asked the county to come in, and that was their recommendation. And their recommendation was that no parking from the Black Horse Pike to Schubert.
That's right.
Bob had asked them, yes, Bob asked them if we can do it to Washington, and they said yes.
So I should just ask Kevin?
So it was their recommendation.
If there's a way that we can obtain permits for gardeners.
Well, this is a safety issue.
It is a safety issue.
As much as I appreciate gardeners, what they do for this town, and the people, I know the people who own it, we can't dictate a safety issue on a few companies in this town, businesses in this town.
Well, can you not make the exception for the funerals? I mean, it's not just gardeners.
Well, that's what I keep saying, guys, it's an enforcement.
It's not.
Do you think the police department?
It's not an everyday happening.
For the 15 minutes or 20 minutes that someone under there.
It's maybe once a week.
And they do have a parking lot across the street, and they do have a parking lot, you know.
Well, I thought, I haven't seen this for a funeral, so I can't say, but I thought after the first flower car.
They can leave and go park.
After that, they had to go into the parking lot.
Correct.
And it has been working.
It's been working, I don't know, I can't say.
I've been out there, it has been working.
Okay, so that's working fine that way.
They park in front of the bus stop on the Pike, which is, when they park the church, they park that whole section around, block the bus stop, they block everything, because it's not yellow in front of the bus stop. So they park all the way up that whole section, and they just park there, it doesn't matter. And it is an enforcement issue. But, paint it all yellow.
If we have to change the ordinance.
I think we need to follow the recommendations of the county and the county.
And we have to change the ordinance.
But if you're following that recommendation, county, you are going to take away parking from those residents on East Hamlet.
I don't think she's saying it's not fair.
Wait a second. You're talking about taking away parking from the residents. Look. No. Some of those residents have a giant parking lots in the back. They have driveways.
It decreases the value of their home.
Very rarely does anybody park in front of those houses.
We're not even talking about the houses, Patty.
No, we're not talking about the houses.
I know that, but he brought that up, but I'm saying.
Yeah, go forward.
Go back. Forget go back.
Yeah.
Yeah, not from Ben Boyd back. I wouldn't do that.
You want to get closer to the Black Horse Pike.
Leave that Pike.
Just leave that alone.
Special permit or just.
Because it comes down into the two lanes right there by St. Teresa's. It's not two lanes all the way to Schubert, so it only comes down when it comes to that turn.
So don't go toward Schubert.
It does decrease.
No, we don't have to.
We don't have to do that, because we don't need to.
But isn't it a state law that you can't park 25 feet from a corner anyway? Or isn't that a state law?
I think it's 25 feet.
25 feet. I remember that on my.
25 feet.
Well.
It was only 10 years ago.
You know, bring the ordinance, we'll start chiseling that, we'll go out there, we'll measure it, we'll just change the ordinance.
10 years ago.
Paint it yellow.
You know, your license 10 years ago?
We can just modify the ordinance.
Why not? Why not go to the Black Horse Pike?
I just feel that, you know, I think.
What's your agenda, Paul? What's going on? Tell us the whole thing.
Well, you know, I'm the only one here that has worked the funerals at gardeners. I'm the only one here that has.
I don't think anybody's saying you don't have a park there.
We're not saying during a funeral, not to.
Hold on for a minute. I'm the only one here who's handled car accidents out there. It was my recommendation to do it the way we're doing it now.
Yes.
And it's working yet. I do go to Church of St. Teresa. I do park on a Black Horse Pike. I see sometimes the parking where Mr. Farrell is saying, yes. Is it somewhat unsafe? I understand what he's saying. But the volume of traffic at the time, what he's saying, is not as much as it is during like a Friday night, a Wednesday, or a Thursday night. What I'm saying is that I think you're making a problem when there really is none. I think we've addressed the problem where the pedestrians are crossing at St. Teresa's School, where they pick up for children, for the carnival. I think we addressed it. I think the church is happy, the school's happy. I think the people at Gardner's were very accepting of it. I explained to them, I trained them. Wendy Gardner, she understood it. I went out, I said, look, park them up to here, and park them in the park lot. They've been doing it.
So when is this occurring that it's a problem? When are we talking about the funerals? Is there a problem with the funerals?
Church.
So people at church, now what about the people at church? Now you're talking about cars, but what about
people at church are parking from the Black Horse Pike up to the yellow.
Right. And when that same thing church, with,
same thing with
one
way.
Why don't we ask the church to tell people to stop parking there?
Well, because
you can't. You're not allowed to park there anyway.
No,
it's against the law to park there.
But they do.
So then tell the officers to write them tickets.
But there's no yellow there.
You know, it's not allowed to be there, but write them tickets. That's what you're all saying.
I know.
Well,
you're all saying,
so that they know they're
but you're all saying people. You want to write people tickets.
No, we're not saying that. We're saying.
But he said if you paint that yellow, and then we don't allow gardeners there anymore, that's inconvenient for. I mean, I drive to work every single day.
We're not saying about not allowing gardeners.
Well, gardeners, is that what you're interpreting as?
Gardeners is there once in. I mean,
once not every day. Day.
It's not every day.
Well, what are you interpreting? Though? Why do you think it'll potentially be gardeners?
Because I think you're bringing up an issue. If someone does get assaulted.
Can we
not? Where there's an accident that does happen,
no.
And the police department do not enforce it, are we actually liable because we did not enforce
yellow.
It?
No, that we knew that
just was non-parking, and we allowed gardeners to park
no,
there.
No, there's a regular.
That's my whole thing. If we allow gardeners to park there and violated a no parking zone, and a traffic accident occurred,
I thought it was a no parking zone.
Isn't it a no parking zone now?
Yes.
No.
It's a lane.
No, it's not.
It's driving.
It's
only no parking in the yellow area.
It's a lane.
It's a lane.
It's not no parking zone.
It's a lane.
It's a lane.
Okay, it's not no parking zone.
They're parking in the middle of
the street.
Yeah.
They are. They all
have
to be
yellow. He's got one agenda. I'm just saying that, you know, this is what we all have.
I don't mean to be on the opposite of all you guys, and not that I'm, Paul's got a different perspective. I'm sorry, I haven't seen any problems there, but I drive certain times of the day.
You should go well, there at 4 o'clock. Go there at 4 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon when everybody's parking there and you're trying to go somewhere.
I'm 6:30 in the morning every day.
At 11 o'clock on a Sunday morning and they're all parking there and you're trying to get
you can't get by.
Eleanor, you hear? Once again, you know me. I would write a ticket for every single person and tow all the cars.
And here's the problem.
It's not yellow, so they
but it's no parking. You're parking in
they
the lane.
They still do it because
let me tell you what's happening
yellow.
Now. Now, people are parked there. Now, there's that lane is the only lane. Now, then people now are driving on this lane.
This is what?
This is all yellow, and the other people are trying
so
to go around
it's not,
it.
It's, why don't we?
Now, they're trying to
well,
make
why are you against parking?
We have to change the ordinance
because,
and put the parking.
Because if you make it no parking.
It is already no parking.
Councilor,
if we paint it yellow.
Please, I don't know if I'm right on this or not. If we make it no parking and we allow gardeners to park there and an accident happens, we could possibly be liable because we are allowing an unlawful act to happen.
But we do it in Volk School and we do it in Dan thing and they do it in Spangle.
Am I correct?
There could be some susceptibility.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's yellow and gardeners can't
it
park.
It is
there.
Different than
okay.
All the other schools because it's such a high traffic area. So if it's a legal situation, we need to have that answer for what we need.
I mean, in essence, it could be. I mean, if you're creating a situation in which people are not supposed to park there, and you allow them to park there, and no one does anything to progressively enforce that issue, and something does happen.
Cars and gets hit.
It gets hit.
That's a problem.
Then at some point, there's a potential for them to bring in the municipality.
But they're not allowed to park there.
But that's your cut both ways, correct?
No, that's
if you do something and they're parking in the roadway, you didn't prevent it, you could be just as liable for not taking action to cure it. So, it's a
there's no signs, even though it's in the yellow, there's no signs that say no parking.
In the yellow, it is.
Yeah,
no,
yep.
I'm saying even though it's not yellow, there's no sign
no.
from where the yellow stops
no.
to the corner that says no parking because you're within 20 feet of an intersection.
And the fact that it's yellow here, a little bit of the.
How about sign that says funeral parking only?
That's what I mean. Yes.
And we do that. That makes sense.
But that's a state road, and you're going to have to get the county. State to say,
county.
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 County. You're going to have to talk to Kevin at the county and see if that's something that they'll allow.
I don't think they'll allow.
But if you put funeral parking
that
on,
makes the most sense.
That's
fine.
Attending the funeral.
Yeah.
Parking here.
But that's what lines up.
Anyway. Funeral director parking only.
Yeah, funeral director parking only, maybe.
What do you think of that one?
I think it's fine the way it is, but you're the ones that make the ordinances.
I say funeral directed parking, I don't think, but you gotta get it okay.
I have to look at it again, the ordinance out.
Well, you can ask, yes, I mean, that to me, that's a start.
We had a report that said, painting yellow from Black Horse Pike to Detroit High School. Which was ridiculous, like you said, you're not gonna let people who lived in that, those houses park.
So bringing them down again, they're already told you they wanna go.
Yeah, so that, we've already gotten from the county what they wanna do. They don't want anybody.
They were very upset when they saw that people parked there.
Yeah, but they're not enforcing it either, they're not doing anything.
They said the police have, our police.
But they're not doing, they're not.
But our police should be enforcing it. It really comes down, I mean, our police should be enforcing it, there are people parking there, they should not be parking that close to the edge of the intersection.
They're not doing anything wrong, it's not painted yellow.
But they're parking within 20, it's like.
No, they're not parking that far up.
But they can't tell it's a road.
It's a lane.
It's a lane.
Yeah, I.
But they've always done it that way.
So mileage and paint.
I'm thinking of another area where there's a lane like that. I'd like to just pull over and start. We'll have to look at it again, if you wanna change your, you have to bring, you have to write it up and you have to introduce it in two readings.
That was one of St. Marie Goretti's arguments.
Nice job, Bob.
There was no.
It's all fired up for nothing.
No, I'm not doing it for that reason, it's a hazard, that's why.
It is a hazard, it is a hazard.
That's my main traffic, I travel.
But I mean, I like, you know, can we get the church involved, can we get the funeral?
They already know that they want to.
They're fine with us painting yellow.
We already did do that.
He wants it painted yellow again. And what is Gardner saying?
Gardner's very happy the way we did it. The church and the school are very happy the way we did it. Everybody's satisfied.
Well, then I think we have to have another meeting.
Yeah, but.
He's saying the opposite of what you guys are saying.
Well, the church is utilizing the parking, so they're gonna be happy. The school ain't there on Saturday and Sunday, so they don't even know what's going on. It's a ridiculous comment, the whole thing is ridiculous what we're having. Paint the stupid curves yellow, tell gardeners they can't park there anymore, simple as that. You can't dictate safety on a business, simple as that. I don't know what we're even discussing this for. It's ludicrous. Come on, let's go.
Okay, Mr. Root, you're up.
Progress.
On the shield, right? Did you guys have to go, are you okay?
Yeah, you wanna go for Mr. Norm?
Yeah, go to your thing.
Okay. Shut up, Bob. No, we have a nice.
Can I tell you, would you like to say something?
Yes, I would like to tell you that we collected $1,187,000 in change of the tax sale.
Is that a record?
And 960-something thousand of that is our premiums.
Ms. Kendall, was that a record?
Was that number?
It is.
Was that number?
It was a record, no?
960-something thousand, I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, our premiums, which will sit in our bank account.
Collecting interest.
Until the liens are redeemed. On the exorbitant amount of interest that you have now. See you guys.
Thank you. But Ms. Kendall, why do you think we did so well with our tax sale?
Because we didn't have an electronic tax sale.
Wow.
And what was the difference in the electronic tax sale?
Is this, did you rehearse this?
I'm leaving the witness.
Tell them for last week.
Chesman, tell them.
That's a problem.
Why do I think? Because it's a blind auction, and they have to, the large companies bid as much as they can.
And there's no wink across the table.
And yet there is not, so it's all.
It's convenient as well.
I think it really opened it up for more people to bid.
The morning of state.
Well, it only became the law, how long ago did this become the law?
Three years ago,
so. Out of 565 municipalities, about 80. So Runnymede is one of 80. We're leaders. As we're fighting over 40 feet of yellow carpet. Leaders. Oh, we came 270 back. I'm sorry. That is a lot. So you're happy about that?
I'm waiting for the big shopping center next to the Acme was Helene Masolva, which was one of our big headache. So I'm waiting for the link holder to pay the 2015 taxes.
Which is how much?
Which will be another $100,000.
Good.
And they've already paid $120,000, which was awesome. 2014.
Could you imagine a large municipality?
That's
this number would be 10 times
for
the
us,
size
that kills, of that kills us.
Go make that a bigger
real type. The only thing I still don't understand, and I don't know who can explain this.
Absolutely.
A parcel of land that this same owner was.
was in front of the planning board to build houses. That went to tax sale.
So those are this one.
We're talking about 23 acres, around 23 acres, so now it's a municipal. Why would somebody want something, I understand they want more short, side wages and things like that. Why not 23 acres?
No, how's that count?
That I didn't understand.
Well, I mean, they may not have done the.
Not really, I have one more thing to do. We have closed session, we're gonna do it.
You're free to leave at any time.
You can all do that, but then when I did actually click on Google Maps, I'm just asking what else.
This is our first contract.
We know what happened with some of these companies, you know.
That's very important, was our money coming.
I think it's awesome.
Okay, Mr. Wright, it's up to you. And then we're gonna, I'd like to have at least a closed session to go over the public works contract so that they'll be able to vote next week.
Okay, because you have to read the whole contract, right, that's our policy.
We read it, we should read it, but not at this time, because they haven't, the other side hasn't signed yet. We have a new policy, we do not sign a contract until the other side signs first.
There is no contract yet, then still has to be.
It's a draft. Are you in writing?
I'm gonna go over the draft.
I'm gonna go over the draft.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't have it with me, do you have that?
I do.
Okay, so you can get it to me or you can go over.
Bring it up.
I know.
I will just quickly go over our issues. Basically, I slash finance has been working with our professionals to get this bond sale done more or less on top of everything else for the last 2 weeks. So this has been everything that we've been doing for the most part. I had a 70-minute conference call with Moody's to get our issue rated and to get the borrower basically rated. We haven't been rated since 2008. And they have a very specific process, so they said that your date is November 2nd to get the notice from us. Then we have 2 hours from receipt of it, per SEC rules, to respond back in case we think anything is incorrect in it. So the moral of the story is on November 2nd, we'll have our rating. The tentative date for the actual sale is November 11th, with the closing prior to Thanksgiving is the goal. The only issue, and this is related to the budget, is because of the way that this is packaged, we will need to pay the interest on what's being paid off for 2015. So that will be required to transfer. I think the amount pending will be $21,000. So it was unanticipated, but I think we'll be able to cover that without a problem. So that's more or less what's been going on for bond sale. I have a copy of the last one down on the table. It's the official statement. That's what everybody's working towards, and it goes out to the investors. Just so someone, she took it.
Okay.
I have another copy back in the office.
So.
But that's the goal. Whatever, you know, it has all of our demographic information in it, you know, the county, the employment, things of that nature.
Was this that, the official statement?
Yes, that's it. Discuss the borrowers, talks about the arrangements of the sale, that's a copy of our financials. So basically, as part of the surveillance, we went over some of the projections and things of that nature, which is looking at the big numbers, just the top five, more or less. The fees and permits are on track. Municipal court fines is 130 for the year, we're at 128, 2 months left to go. Interest and cost on taxes was budgeted at 80, we're at 131. Tax sale, great job, Joyce. EMS billing is budgeted at 245, we're at 233 to date with 2.5 months left to go based on the way that the postings for bank statements happen. We get revenues in directly from the fire department. We also have wires for Medicare to go in and part of the bankrupt process. Receipts from delinquent taxes is budgeted 360 and we brought in unaudited 563. So that is definitely going to help us regenerate the $473,000 of surplus that we utilized in the budget this year, which is our goal to replenish our surplus. On the expenditure side, one of the things that we're looking at is engineering OE. And I'm not knocking Mark this time around, I'm just saying that basically with the costs and trying to make the project work for the demo, the question is, do we charge part of the engineering fee to the operating account? If we have the ability in the bond, we'll cover what we can, but the overflow will go against the operating account. The other area we're keeping an eye on is buildings and grounds. We have multiple issues that take place to get charged there. I know one of our priorities through transfers after November 1st, that's another note, we can do transfers after November 1st, is to get the heater unit for $8,000 in the Public Works garage so that the salt won't be frozen in the truck and they have to be up there with ice picks before they go out and saw working in the shop. There's a couple other needs in the borough that need to flow through there, so that's the other area that I'm actually watching right now. And the reason that I wrote draft and stressed that is because I will, for the council meeting, update the director. So that's basically.
That's good thing that Tom did then. That's good that we.
And as all I did was put in a rec.
Well, I asked for 2 years and nobody took, we couldn't get it done, so I'm glad that he's able to get it done.
Staff person, rec.
Was there anything else? No? Okay, I think we should go in a closed session to talk about.
And do good welfare.
And do good welfare before, and then we're not gonna do any action when we come back?
Right.
Okay, this portion of this meeting is open to the public. Anyone wishing to speak, please come to the microphone. Seeing no one, is there a motion to close the good welfare portion?
I'll second it.
All right, all in favor? Okay, this is resolution 15-145, resolution going to closed session to allow for a conversation about one personnel issue and a contract negotiation. We'll need about 20 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes. Is there a motion?
I have a motion.
I'll second. All in favor?